A good afternoon and welcome to Future Stars Brian C Sports Nutrition. Massive show on today. James Harms from the Melbourne Footy Club. We'll talk to him about what happened yesterday. Will they play finals? AFLW. Ebony Marinoff is going to be in the house talking to Abby Holmes. It's all happening in here on Future Stars. But the man down to our left, he stole the show last night. Tommy Logan joins us from the Cats. Welcome to Future Stars, mate.
G'day, boys. How you going?
And what a big night it was last night as I just welcomed the rest of the panel. Shifter Sheen and Terry Wallace is so important that I had to get to him first. But did it with class and respect. You and Andrew Mackey, you've played together for so long. Talk us through it. Talk us how it came about last night.
Yeah, Mack and I had a chat during the week and we didn't want to do the usual press conference. We thought we'd just hopefully get the win and be able to say goodbye to the crowd and tell the boys after the game, and it all worked out pretty well. Obviously we got the win first and we secured the top two position, and then we could say goodbye to the faithful. So it was a great moment for us.
Now, was it when you decided you were going to retire, because you're still playing very good football, I heard that when Luke Hodge decided he retired, and you thought that if Luke Hodge is retiring, then I maybe should too?
Yeah, I think it was more so the fact that he was a player I played a junior footy, I played under 16s with, and it was, I suppose, a penny drop moment. He was, as I said, he was a player I played with young, and it was like the guys around me who I started playing junior football with are now retiring and finishing up, and it was something that I just began to think a lot more about after that moment.
Tom, I was down there last night. It was so respectful. I mean, the entire crowd sort of stuck around and really got involved in it as well.
Yeah, they did. They did play. They're a great crowd to play in front of, and we've managed to get a lot of wins over the years and enjoyed my time down there. But it was good to say goodbye and move on to, you know, the next 4 weeks.
So it is a big 4 weeks. Is that the best you played last night? I mean, that was an awesome performance against a side that's been in really good form the last month.
It was a pretty consistent four-quarter effort, Brownie. Yeah, I think, you know, obviously we're having a few injuries, Joel out, guys like Sammy Manigola and Stevie Motlop starting to, you know, get his body back into some good condition and show some real form. And I think as a team, we're starting to really gel together.
Now, Tom, you had to say farewell because no one knows whether you're actually going to go back down to Geelong and play another game or not. Get the gut feeling that if it works out that you play GWS again, you might have another farewell game down at Geelong, but it looks like if you play Richmond, that it'd be more likely to be at the MCG. I think most of us think that, you know, the club deserves their own final. What's the club feel on it?
Look, as from a player's perspective, we're happy to play anywhere. We're obviously, the grand final's held at the MCG, so we're going to have to play a big game there eventually. We think if obviously if we play GWS, it should be down at Simmons Stadium. But look, we'll leave that to the powers to be, and we're happy to play anyway.
We asked your retiring buddy on the Sunday Footy Show where he wanted to play, and he said, "Oh, 90,000 MCG for me."
Yeah. look, it's as I said, it'd be great to play in front of a massive crowd. I know Richmond have got a huge following, and it'd be a great spectacle.
Last night, Toby Green copped an injury similar area to what you copped, and just watching this vision, I mean, courage to go back, courage to get up. But then you had a chat to him after that.
Yeah, I did. I just made sure that he was feeling okay and said, make sure you check your urine at half time if you get a chance, because it looked like he got hit right in the kidney, and he was obviously in a fair bit of pain, so I just wanted to ensure he was okay.
Got one of your old teammates going around against you last night, Stevie J. It's sort of, you know, you talk about your retirement. It's coming to the end, obviously, for Stevie as well. Do you think they'll play him? How do you think this will play out? And is there any sort of interaction between you guys out on the park as well?
Yeah, look, obviously we're really good mates. We're good mates with Stevie. And look, it's been well documented. He's had his body issues, his knees caused him a fair bit of grief. So, look, I think he's still a super dangerous player. And, you know, we are in September and he does love the big stage. So I've got no doubt he'll be getting his body right and hoping to play.
Question for you, player, as the only coach on here. Stevie J, you know Leon Cameron very well. Do you play him because of his finals experience, or do you leave him out and hope that one of the young players, probably a Matty De Boer, comes in and gets the job done?
I've been 100% up until this stage play him. Being down there last night, he was that far off the mark that I don't think he can turn that around in 2 weeks.
Now, Tommy, we're going to go back to your mention on Luke Hodge, because that's the first time you come on the radar of all the clubs. It was 2000, 17 years ago. Yeah. And, of course, a couple of months later, this Luke Hodge that you'd played with Vic Country, was playing on the MCG for the Falcons. But you played with him, Vic Country, under 16 Nationals, and over in Tassie, as I recall. What do you remember of Luke, and what was Tom Lonigan like at that stage? Yeah, tell us about your physique back then.
Tom Lonigan was a broomstick at best. I think I weighed about 68 kilos, and I was about 191 or two. But look, Hodgie's, he's filled out a little bit, but he was a pretty big-bodied player back then. He was an early developer, and you could see the competitive nature in him back then. He was the best player in the carnival, and he had all the traits that made him the number one pick.
How close were you to ending up as a Western Bulldog?
Look, I was pretty close. It was obviously a 30-year-old, you have to consider those things, and you know, obviously your family come into it, and you know, looking after them. So it was a big call, but at the end of the day, I'm glad I made the right decision and stayed at Geelong.
Brownie, we saw Luke Hodges, a 16-year-old. We're actually going to have a look later. Last year we looked at next year's draft. We're actually going to go one step further and have a look at the 2019 draft of a group of 16-year-olds later in the show. And I got a little bit of a story about a dual premiership Hawthorn player who was let go by his football club before he got to 100 games, that 25 years later might come back to bite
you. You are a forward thinker, player. Hey, Tommy Stewart, before we get off the Cats, a couple of teammates of yours that you've been working with, young players. I mean, he's not a young player, he's a late bloomer, but we had him on the show last week. Ripping fella.
He's a great fella, Tommy. He's got a great head on his shoulders too. He's pretty cool, calm and collected. Got great speed, and he's a fantastic size. So we were really surprised we got him at pick 40. I know the coaches and recruiting group were. We thought he'd go in the top 25, and so we're really happy to get him at 40.
The Rising Star is coming up, and we put together our top five list. We went to Shifter. He didn't want to talk about his. But I've gone with Charlie Curnow on top. I just think his impact has been enormous. Andy McGrath second, Ryan Burton, I thought Sam Powell-Pepper was brilliant, and then we've split the last two. I've got Eric Hipwood and Plough.
Yeah, well, mine, Andy McGrath for some of the defensive actions, which we'll talk about in a second. Ryan Burton for my four vote. Charlie Curnow, who very well may be the best player in the future, but and then Powell-Pepper and Witherden for me.
So we've got the same top three, but they're in different orders. Why have you gone McGrath number one?
Well, just as we're having a look at a little bit of vision here of Curnow, I mean, his power marking's been magnificent. I just went for Andrew McGrath because I think both offensively, defensively, he's been a magnificent player. And really, when I have a look at it, I think everyone looks at the offensive actions, Tom. Not many people look at the defensive part of the game. And he has almost halved every player that he's played on. In Adelaide, first game, played on Rioli and Bruce. Only a couple of weeks ago, did a job on Eddie Betts. So I looked at the defensive part of the game as well.
Yeah, look, it's a great year for him, a great development year. If he goes into the midfield in the coming years, I think he'll learn a lot from this year. He's obviously, as you said, done a great number of jobs on those players, and I think it will just enhance his game even further.
The Brisbane Lions now have the number one pick. Let's have a look at some of the top draft picks maybe going number one this year. What do they need?
Well, I mean, you need just a great player at pick number one, and they have been very, very keen on sort of saying, and we've put up these four names, Shifter as the guys who are more likely to go, but they had mentioned a bit about the country aspect for them, that they will particularly look at the country kids.
Yeah, Chris Fagan said that very publicly. He's looking for, well, a hybrid midfielder, and they've made that very clear. The boys from country Australia, particularly country Victoria, have got to move anyway, and they might as well move up to Brisbane and then stay there as a long-term player. So I think the names that you see up there are probably very much on their list. But wait, whatever you do, wait. Grand finals are pretty important around Australia, and if you go back to Adam Good kicking six in the grand final, still side bottom 10, you'll change your ratings over the next month, so don't go too early, Brisbane.
Let's hear that grab from Chris Fagan now.
You sit down to do your list management meeting this morning. Will you factor that in? Or will you pick the best player in the draft, regardless of where he's from, or will you say it's probably safer if there's a good local kid?
Yeah, look, I think our recruiters look closely at that potential go-home factor. I think it's relevant. You know, that's probably why, if you look at our list, there's a lot of Queenslanders, there's a lot of big country boys, because they don't have a choice. They've got to move away from home. So.
But we only had to look, Brownie, last year when you have a look at what they did. So they've already started this process. McCluggage, Cox from the Ballarat region.
Obviously, makes sense.
Obviously Witherden from the Geelong region. So they've already started that process. You just sense that Paddy Dow is the name that's just pushing up and becoming more and more prevalent shifter when it's coming to the time of making this selection.
He certainly fits the criteria. He's a boy from Swan Hill. He's down at Geelong Grammar School and has played well at All-Australia in the middle of the year, and he's on the up, he's on the improve, not yet just 18, so he's a boy that bursts from the stoppages, he hits the scoreboard as well, and no doubt he's in the conversation for the Brisbane Lions.
Now, Shifter, I know that you're one who loves the history of the game, and you've been watching and tracking a young man who's got a great heritage in the game, and particularly with the club that that you love.
Yeah, we're talking about young Toby Wooler, of course. An unusual name, Wooler, but Fred Wooler's well known to any Geelong supporter. Premiership captain, of course, way back in the 60s in Bobby Davis's days. And this boy's emerged the last couple of years, a very likely type as a draftee, 193 centimetres, and he has got a big tank. So he'll present as that third marking forward. I seen him kick four goals yesterday. One was an absolute ripper.
So what is he to Fred?
He is the grandson.
Grandson.
The grandson. And so at my age, you start to see the grandsons come through, which is fantastic. And, of course, Fred there watching him play and enjoying the journey of young Toby.
Well, we have father-son, but should we, for the history of the game, have father and grandson?
Well, Collingwood might suggest that because they've got a ripper as well. That's Ed Richards. We mentioned him a couple of times on the show. So he's Ronnie Richards' grandson. So it makes him Louis Richards' grandnephew. He was fantastic yesterday. He's a redhead, a cross halfback, a lefty.
He certainly is a redhead.
Oh, it's fantastic the way he plays. He's sure all over again. Reads the angles brilliantly, sets the play up. He's got speed, elite kicking ability, and he's one really to watch as the draft comes around later in the year.
Nice work, Shifter. Time for the INC Elite Performer of the Week. Train hard, live large with INC Sports Nutrition. Jack Higgins is flying at the moment, a lazy bag of seven.
And he's a boy that can play midfield, so you see him as a small forward. He just gets the ball wherever he is placed. He's remarkably consistent. He's a guy that you've seen a bit of, Terry, as well.
Yeah, I really like him. I just think that the competitive aspect of him, Tom, is something that every AFL club would want. You know, you just want to have the kids that you know will come and compete.
That's all they want, yeah. They want those competitors who can get it done on the big stage, and he looks like he's got those attributes.
And have a look at this fine specimen sitting over at the McCafe, James Harms from the Melbourne Football Club. Try McCafe's finest barista-made coffee ever at McCafe or drive-through. He's going to be up next talking about where the Demons are at. Are they going to play finals? What happened yesterday? That's up next on Future Stars for INC Sports Nutrition. Welcome back to Future Stars, Brian C. Sports Nutrition. It's available only at Chemist Warehouse. Very good friends of ours on the show, as is this next man, James Harms from the Melbourne Footy Club. Welcome to Future Stars, mate.
Thanks for having me, guys.
Tough morning to come on. Obviously, the fate is in other people's hands at the moment. You would have thought you would have won that game yesterday. How's the feeling being post-game and now?
Yeah, obviously a little bit disappointing around the Varunge yesterday. But, yeah, as you said, we've got to wait and see. And hopefully the things go away and we can... you know, play our first finals in 11 years, so...
It was talk in the paper today and on radio that the Demons choked. I was of the opinion that you just weren't aggressive and intense enough. You only laid two tackles in the first 20 minutes. I mean, choking's where you miss goals or miss kicks. You didn't do any of that. You just couldn't get your hands on the footy.
Yeah, well, Collingwood definitely bring it up to us as well. They had a very high pressure rating early in the game and, yeah, we struggled to get our hands on the ball and we struggled to put on pressure, so... you know, we pride ourselves on contested ball and we probably lacked that yesterday.
What about your own year? How have you sort of summed up the year thus far? We hope it's going to go into a finals campaign.
Yeah, personally I think I've had a pretty consistent year. Started down back at the start of the year and now, moved a bit more forward. So, yeah, luckily the last few weeks I've been kicking a few goals, but I couldn't get on the end of anyone.
You kicked three in this quarter, didn't you?
Yeah, three in the first against Saints. I was pretty lucky to get a lick of the ice cream.
A lick of the ice cream, right? Yeah. Tell us about that one.
Well, we were going to ask you about that because we've got, and when this vision, the great vision of yourself to celebrate, and we've got some audio that you just said, I got a lick of the ice cream. Now, we've got some audio of a lot of your players saying this.
It's a little motto we have, just the old lick of the ice cream. So if you get an assist, you'll get your lick of the ice cream sometime soon. So that's something that we've had lately. And
if you play your right role and you do the right thing at the right time, everyone's going to get their little lick of the ice cream. So
I was lucky to have a lick of the ice cream there, but yeah, it was good.
It's a good tasting ice cream. What is it?
Troy Chaplin rang it in this year. It's just, you know, when you get on the end of it. So he says, you know, you do the team things and you'll finally get a lick of the ice cream at the end of the day. So, yeah, just a little funny saying we have.
Tommy, the professionalism in the game, how important is it when you come into AFL footy? AFL footy's hard enough anyway, just to make sure that you are dotting the I's and crossing the T's with your professionalism.
Yeah, look, it's something that it does, for some, it does take time. I know I was late to quite a few meetings early on and had the likes of Brendan McCartney that hit me between the eyes and straightened me up. So you need that footy club culture to help you along sometimes.
So, James, to me, we heard a little bit that you had to sort of deal with this. It's not so much about you, but just we have a lot of young kids who think that they're doing everything right. Can you explain to them just the little bits of professionalism that you needed to pick up on, or perhaps you could help other youngsters sort of when they come into the system?
Yeah, I guess when you come into the system, you're pretty young and immature. So when I came in, it's just like things, getting to meetings on time, doing extra ice baths, seeking information off coaches. So I was probably a little bit shy, and it took me a while to actually understand what it took to be an AFL footballer. So yeah, just for young guys coming through the system, it's probably, really taking control of your career and trying to get the best out of yourself every day.
As a young fellow, we were doing a run around Aberfeldy Park one day, and I thought that you had to go around this tree. So say that's the tree, you had to go around there. I thought, well, I'm at the back anyway, so I might just cut that off. And it was probably the 10 metres I might have cut off. This clown here was sitting in the tree. I didn't know. He was in the tree trying to spy, just trying to catch somebody. Took me into my office, into his office that day, and said, mate, kids would give an arm and a leg if they had to play this caper. And my comment back to him was, and it didn't go down that very well, well, if they're going to have an arm or a leg, they're not going to play very well, are they?
Yeah, now, James, we're going to go back to your path. Devon Meadows boy, Dandenong Stingrays. And so 4 years ago, you made Vic Country. We'll see some vision of you playing there. But what were your memories of your draft year 2013?
I made a lot of good friends down at Dandenong. Billy Hartung and Jonesy, they both got drafted that year. I remember...
Is that redhead?
Yeah, there's a photo. My sister tried to dye my hair.
So you're a natural redhead?
No, I'm not natural red. Just the...
Okay.
Yeah, a bit of a mix up there. But yeah, I remember we played in the grand final against Eastern Rangers and we lost by 100 points, so that wasn't great. But yeah, it was a really special year. I guess things happen really quick, and before you know it, you're on an AFL list, so yeah.
But it didn't happen draft night. You had to wait a few more days for the rookie draft where you went choice two. Disappointment, bitter disappointment. What were your feelings that night?
Yeah, I was obviously really disappointed, I just said to myself, there's always a rookie draft. And I went down, I was training at Casey Scorpions. So I think that's probably where I got aligned with Melbourne. And I got picked up in the rookie draft. And I've learnt a lot along the way, and I probably wouldn't change a thing. So, yeah.
Well, thanks to our good friends at the Chemist Warehouse. You leave with this great gift pack. And it is Father's Day coming up. So spoil Dad with big brand fragrances for Chemist Warehouse, the real house of fragrances. This Father's Day, they're all there. The Clem, the Mercedes ones. Totally Workwear, these King G Urban Boots are made from only the best soft polished leather. They retail at about $240 a pair, a night for two at Melbourne's Parkview Hotel in St Kilda Road, close to everything that is Melbourne. Macca's, $50 McCafe voucher. Head in to taste their finest ever barista-made coffee. A voucher thanks to Sammy & Co. Get down to 447 Chapel Street down in South Yarra. Sammy & Co. dresses a lot of AFL players. They look very good. Clubmandalay.com.au. Around of four and cart hire down there. Still gift vouchers thanks to our mates at Still and their awesome battery-powered garden tools. A delicious meal just over the back here, Etihad Stadium and our studios. $100 voucher, platform 28 down to the Docklands. And a HD Sports action camera thanks to the Telstra store in Thomastown. 69 Dalton Road, and this fantastic Dometic Cool Icebox. Dometic Mobile, living made easy. Mate, that's a big prize pack. I hope you play finals. I hope the weight is good today. You get the result you need, and good luck.
Thanks for having me, boys.
That was James Harms, superstar. Very good set of teeth, too. I hope Tony Jones is taking notice of that. Time to get to the Tobin Brothers, multicultural player of the year. Over the years, Tobin Brothers Funerals has developed experience and expertise in the funeral customs of numerous faiths and cultures and serves a broad spectrum of Melbourne's multicultural community. Aidan Boner from the Dandenong Stingrays. Bonner is this week's shifter.
Yeah, and two worlds colliding. So mum's from PNG, dad from Scotland, and this is a powerful player. Seen him yesterday playing at centre forward, 190 centimetres. He looks a real draftee for mine. Had some ACL injuries, overcome two, so it's just late in the year that we've seen some glimpses of this very powerful forward or midfielder from the Dandenong Stingrays.
And all the nominations so far, and Aiden goes in there in week number 19. Still plenty more to come on Future Stars for INC Sports Nutrition. Plough, 2 years' time, his phantom draft for 2019. That's up next. James Harms has been here. We'll speak to Tommy Lonning a little bit more. INC Future Stars. He'll go to the break. You're watching Future Stars for INC Sports Nutrition. Train hard, live large with INC Sports Nutrition. It's informed, sports approved and available only from Chemist Warehouse. Very good friends of ours. Plough is over at the Plasma.
Well, Brownie, most of us in this competition only worry about the draftees a few months before they're about to get drafted, and we all sort of start to concentrate on it. But at AFL Clubland, they're tracking these boys right from years and years prior. So last year we had a look at next year's draft. We just sort of wanted to take it another step forward and have a look at the 2019 draft off the back of the under-16 championship. So just have a look at how far out the AFL clubs are actually tracking these guys. Tommy, when we have a look at some of the guys that have come through, these have been the stars of the 16s over the years gone past.
Yeah, look, and there's some great names there. You look at the GWS crew there, Dylan Scheel, Treloar, Taylor Adams, Devin Smith, they're all superstars of the game now. So you can see why clubs track these guys from such an early age.
Yeah, well, Darcy Moore is one of the guys that we had a look at, and becoming a great player as well. This is having a look at a skinny Darcy Moore going back to his period of time. But even when you see them from last year, Shifter, we see all the boys who are going for Rising Star 12 months ago and the lot that are going up for this year's National Draft.
Yeah, some move very quickly. They'll jump from the 16s like Luke Hodgeby, stars there, and go very early in the draft. And others will take time. They'll be the taller, lighter kids that, you need to be a genius to find them at the under-16s. But history says they were probably there because 46 every year progress on average to the AFL from that under-16 championship.
Well, Tom, you've seen a lot of father-sons come through your football club. Look, a lot of these boys are not necessarily right at the pinnacle of the top end of it at the moment, but they're all players that their clubs will be keeping a real eye on.
Yeah, absolutely. And you look at the names there, it looks as though Essendon and Port will have a big say in that draft.
We're looking far and wide these days to try to find these young boys, remembering it. We're talking about projection out a couple of years still at the moment. These are some of the international boys that the clubs will be certainly looking at as well, Shifter.
Yeah, well, certainly the AFL says it's a game for everyone. And we talked about the boy from PNG last weekend, a boy from Port Moresby that really was taking the opportunity to play with the open age players in the International Cup and show what he can do. We call him Ace, and he's a boy that will probably end up in the Gold Coast Suns Academy up there in Queensland, and he's so clean. His skills are elite. He loves the game. You can see he celebrates this goal that he kicked right on halftime, and he's a boy that we will follow for the next couple of years.
Well, we know that the AFL Academy will bring out their players, but this is only my look at it as it stands at the moment, going through all the information, going through the vision that we could possibly find. These are guys that haven't made my top 20, but players just to keep a real eye on, because we're talking 2 years projection. Any one of these young men could end up being a top 20 pick by the time that we get there. So now we'll concentrate our mark on the top 20 players as I sort of see them fitting right as it sits at the moment. Shifter, 20 to 11, there's some really nice players in that group.
Well, I love some of the boys that were the MVPs for their state. Jared Dakin, a boy from Launceston, the MVP for Tassie. Mitch Fitzpatrick was the MVP for Queensland. So form on the board is far better than potential in my book, and those boys certainly produced at the level available to them.
Looking at picks 10 to 1 now, some really nice players in this group. We're going to concentrate some vision on some of these young men. Tom, give us a little bit of line on Liam Delahunty, if that's okay.
Yeah, well, as you said before, Plough, because the draft is still 2 years away, recruiters are just looking for something special. And at the moment, this kid has got impeccable hands. He's a great marking forward, and no doubt the recruiters will be keeping a close eye on him.
is certainly one to keep a real eye on over the next couple of years. The next one for me is Keziah Pickett. I just really think that this is a young man that we need to really watch the way that he goes about. A nephew of Byron Pickett. His defensive work so far as a young man coming through the system is absolutely magnificent. We can see that he can kick a goal and get online on offence, but what he does as a defensive forward is absolutely magnificent and super tough. So next up, we're going to just have a little bit of a concentration on another one of the young men, Matthew Rowell. To me, this bloke is just super, super tough. Inside mid, who will work his backside off. He's got 32 possessions and 4 goals in a game of recent time. Starting to really sort of show some elite signs getting through there.
Looked like he already had a lot of power through his hips there.
Absolutely. So we get down to the top two. Emerson Jecker, shifter, another fine acquisition, and a really tall, big, strong key position player.
Yeah, prototype of the modern day forward. He's 196 centimetres already. He turns 16 next month. Unbelievable. He debuted yesterday for the Western Jets at under 18 level down in Gippsland and didn't look out of place at all. Look out for this boy.
Looks highly skilled too from those stats there.
Very, very gifted player and was a star for Vic Metro in the National Championships.
Well, I spoke before this all started off that the Hawthorn Football Club 25 years ago allowed Dean Anderson, a dual premiership player, to leave the football club when he was on 80-odd games to go to St Kilda. It might come back to bite them 25 years later, shifted, because he does look a really fine prospect.
Yeah, he ticks all the boxes, from leadership right through to just performance, playing well in every game at national level. He's been a star at school level as well, and 180-80, he's ready to run as an inside or outside midfielder, hits the scoreboard to boot. We see him here in action where he won the best and fairest medal too in Division 1 of the National Championships this year.
So, Brownie, we've got Noah Anderson at number one at this stage. There's a lot to play out in the next 2 years, but the Hawthorn Football Club would be very, very worried.
Nice work, Plough, as always. We're going to have a look at the TAC up next on Future Stars for INC Sports Nutrition. Welcome back to Future Stars for INC Sports Nutrition. Let's take a look at the TAC results from yesterday. And Dandenong, 9 points over Sandringham, so just eased themselves 2 games clear in third position. Gippsland defeated Western Jets. Northern Knights got the job done against the Murray Bushrangers, who were above them. Oakley, top B bottom, and 88-point thumping there. And a couple of games on today. Geelong Falcons take on as they take that away. But Oakley Chargers clear at the top. As I said, Geelong Falcons second and Dandenong move 2 games clear. Murray Bushrangers and Sandringham fighting it out for the top 4, but Bendigo Pioneers down the bottom end of the ladder.
I love the Sandy versus Dandy game yesterday. I was at that. Finals like. All the good players are back now playing in these matches out of school footy. And the couple of guys watch closely. Ed Newman and Nathan Murphy were 2 boys that really caught the eye. Newman's work at the stoppages was sensational. They were 6 goals down at one stage and he was the one that got them going again. Left footer, played in the midfield. And then Nathan Murphy's a boy that we've talked about a bit on the show, a cricketer. Both these boys, in fact, cricketers, very talented cricketers. Murphy, a boy that can play both ends of the ground. Love that about him. He's got lovely touch in the air with his marking.
It's great to see guys that are good, proficient in a couple of different sports. Have you seen many along the journey that you thought, Tom, could have played either dual sports?
Yeah, Andrew Mackie rated himself as a highly talented cricketer, but I'm yet to see see if he's any good. But Mark Blitzad obviously was on the verge of the Olympics in steeplechasing. And, there's a few others down there as well.
Well, there's other things that I like to look for as well, Shifter, and that's a change of role for particular players. I think everyone's looking at the top-end players, and Cam Rayner yesterday, Aiden Quigley from Gippsland, was given a run-with role to be able to play on them, and I thought he did an outstanding job in this game. So people will look at that to sort of see if, guys who have got the discipline to be able to play on the best, take them on, work hard with them, and then be able to get off them. So recruiters will look at that sort of thing, and Aiden Quigley is somebody who really sort of built up his stocks yesterday.
Nice work, player. Builders Academy Team of the Year. Build your future with buildersacademy.com.au. Hunter Clark goes into the back pocket, and he's flowing at the moment, Hunter.
Well, you can put him back pocket or the midfield, and he was a star yesterday in that big Dandy Sandy game, playing through the midfield. He's got the Rolls-Royce motor, that change in gear, that acceleration that that he can produce when needed to get away from the stoppage. I love the way he exits the stoppage as well. Right and left side, left and right, foot and hand, and he was at his absolute best yesterday. And he gets in the conversation as a first-round draft choice, no doubt.
And the Homebuyers Under 18 Coach of the Year for Homebuyers Centre, coaching you to own it, Justin Winky from the Northern Knights. The boy we're going to talk about is Ethan Penrith. Shifter.
Yeah, next generation academy for the Carlton Footy Club, which means that they can take him like the father-son rule. If there's other bidders, they need to match the bid. He's a boy that played back pocket for Vic Metro. Yesterday, he kicked four goals up forward. This Indigenous boy from out in the Preston area pushed his stocks up with that performance.
Here's some of the coaches we've nominated. $3,000 up for the Home Buyers Centre, coaching you to own it. So they are very good friends of ours. So a $3,000 bounty, and hopefully Matthew Lloyd doesn't get it, because that would be very, very disappointing. A couple of lovely ladies up next on AFLW. Ebony Marinoff we're going to speak to, and it's going to be over at the McCafe. That's up next on Future Stars for INC Sports Nutrition.
Ever since I was little, I wanted to be a tradesman. So I started off, did a couple of weeks work experience as an electrician, but didn't like that and went and worked for my neighbour. Yeah, I love my job now with DG, it's good.
My second year now building with trade school and that, and my family's in it. My brother's a construction manager, which is handy, so learn a bit off him. And Dave's a great boss and just love it.
They came on board about a year ago and they've grown a lot with the company in terms of, you know, their confidence levels and their skill levels and what they train the younger guys too now.
Dave's been really understanding of like footy and that sort of thing. Like, I had to have a couple of days off because I hurt my ankle a couple of weeks ago, so really understanding that sort side of things.
Well, you expect with the staff numbers that we have that they all have outside commitments, whether it be family or sport or whatever they're into. When everyone is clear and communicates well, then everyone understands what's going on.
Well, it's pretty tough, has its days, if you don't get enough sleep and that. And some days it's hard to go to the gym after work, but you just got to push through and hopefully you don't have to do any overtime and then try to get to training before 5:30.
Werribee's been real good. Johnny and the boys out there, they've helped me with my development. They're really understanding of working as a tradie and then playing footy. So, you know, some nights you'll go in there and they'll already have you monitored for like an easy night, so you don't have to train. So they really look after you in that way.
It's sacrifice, really. Training 2 and 3 nights a week, organised here at the club, and then gym sessions, recovery, physio, all those sorts of things. So Dom in the midfield and Riley in the back line, a lot of time they're picking up AFL-listed full-timers. At the end of the day, it all gets down to that communication, developing the relationship with the players to hopefully support them to be the best players they can.
Everyone's end goal is to get picked up by an AFL side, but I had a sit down with Johnny at the start of the year and he talked to me about how it's going to be a long road. It really put me in this perspective of how hard I have to work to get there, and I'm just happy playing VFL at the end of the day, really.
It'll take it step by step, but hopefully Werribee make the finals and just see what happens there with my footy, so take it day by day pretty much.
Welcome back to Future Stars for INC Sports Nutrition. As we headed to the break before, we had a nice little feature from the Builders Academy featuring two Werribee young guns. Builders Academy, very good friends of ours, as is Abby Holmes. And today she's demanded her own time over at the McCafe. Try their finest barista-made coffee ever. She says, Plough gets up there, you get up there. Shifter doesn't get up there that often, but I want my own time over at the McCafe.
Yes, thank you, Brownie. And today I've got a very special guest joining me over at the McCafe. She was an absolute star in season one of the AFLW competition, so much so that she was awarded with a Rising Star nomination in round one and proceeded to take out the Rising Star for the entire competition. But Ebony, thank you so much for joining us on Future Stars.
Thanks for having me, Ebs.
Now, a whirlwind 12 months for you. You were taken with the first pick for the Adelaide Football Club in the inaugural draft at pick 7. you proceed to go through, you know, a full AFL pre-season and then achieve that ultimate success in year one. So what was that like for you?
Yeah, I guess just pretty special, you know, coming out of high school and then hearing about the AFLW League and then, you know, going pick one with Adelaide Football Club and, you know, having quite a successful season and then to win a premiership, you know, never in my wildest dream did I ever think that I'd play AFL at the highest level, but yeah, it was just a whirlwind year, that's for sure.
And we're just looking at some footage now of the grand final, but I myself know that what happens after a grand final win stays after that grand final win, but what were the celebrations like?
Yeah, pretty hectic, I guess. We had to head back to Adelaide on the Sunday and, you know, do that last one on Adelaide Oval, and then I had a few awards nights, so went straight to Melbourne on the Sunday night and then off to Darwin, so another crazy week, but awesome.
And not to mention that that flight to Adelaide the following morning was up at, what, 5 a.m?
Yep, and then the bus to Brisbane and then jumped straight on the plane.
Yes, and quickly I just want to ask you as well about Bec Goddard. She's really has turned into one of those cult figures during the AFLW competition, but she's obviously got that ability of bringing a group together, half the team in Darwin, half in Adelaide. How special was she to have as a coach in season one?
Yeah, really special, and I guess, you know, put it just down to the girls of to make it work. Such a unique situation with half in Darwin and half in Adelaide, but, you know, just drive that, you know, when you're together, make it work, and, you know, we really bonded as a team, and that really shown, and, you know, probably why we had such success.
And your relationship with Erin Phillips, she really has become a great mentor and friend of yours, and she's gone on the record in saying that, you know, you're her third child, along with the twins in Blake and Brooklyn. So how special is the relationship and the bond that you've built with Flip?
Yeah, Flip and I, you know, obviously teammates, but really, you know, formed a great friendship. And, you know, I'm 19 and she's like 32 or something. So, you know, big gap, but we get along like house on fire, almost like a mum and a sister all in one. And she's back in 3 weeks and, you know, can't wait to play footy with... She says that she's retiring when Sean Burgoyne does, so hopefully he plays on for a long more, so I've got a lot more years playing with Flip.
Yeah, and you're a Delicacine assistant back in South Australia. Not many people know this about me, but that was also my first job. Here we've got a beautiful image of you working at Foodland in South Australia, and they must love you because you've provided them with some excellent exposure.
Yeah, they absolutely love it, actually. over in Adelaide, the medias go crazy, so sometimes I have to leave the shift early, but they're all for it and been really supportive and wouldn't have been able to do everything without them.
Yeah. And you are a part of the Allies squad for Team of Origin next week. So let's just have a look at the teams quickly. For the Victorian side, we've got Sarah Tex Perkins up there from Adelaide. They've got some quality players that will be running around on the Etihad Stadium on Saturday night. Lauren Arnell, she's an excellent leader, obviously the skipper of Carlton, but we'll look at the Allies now. You're pumped? What are you looking most forward to?
Yeah, I'm just excited, you know, to play Etihad on Saturday night and Channel 7 prime time and, you know, with a bunch of superstars and, you know, get to play alongside of the likes of Katie Brennan and Lisa O'Day, who I've been playing at Darabin with, and then go back and play with CJ and Randall and Stevie Lee, who got the call-up, which is also exciting, from Darwin, and then to play, you know, against Daisy and Karen Paxman. Yeah, should be an awesome game. Looking forward to it.
Wonderful. And let's just also take a look at some of the VFL results from this weekend. Round 14, Darabin, your side, Noffy, 12-14-86, defeating VU Western Spurs, 4-24. Box Hill having a nice win as well, 8-5-53 against Seaford, 3-3-21. But Noffy, you played with Morphettville Park, sorry, in South Australia, but you've come over to experience football in the VFLW. What has that been like? You've slotted into this Darabin side nicely, rubbing shoulders with the likes of your Daisy Pearce and Katie Brennan's, as you just mentioned.
Yeah, no, it's been awesome. Obviously, at the end of AFLW, I really wanted to challenge myself and thought, what better way to move over to Victoria? Play with VFL at Darabin. A lot of people said, you know, why did you choose Darabin? Such a successful club, but I just wanted to go to a club where I knew I was going to learn and grow and develop as a player and, you know, get to play alongside some superstars and have learned a lot from the likes of Daisy and her leadership, and it's been awesome to play alongside her and Darcy Vessio and Katie Brennan down forward. It's been awesome, you know, delivering the ball to them, and I feel like I've improved immensely. So hopefully, you know, have a good successful season next year with AFLW with Crows.
Oh, Ab, I think we've found your calling over there. A brilliant interview over at the McCafe in Ebony. Congratulations, and we look forward to seeing you again next year.
Thank you.
It's going to be a fantastic year in the AFLW. But up next, Father's Day coming up, and Sam Kerridge from the Carlton Footy Club, well, he went in to the Chemist Warehouse to see what they had on offer for Father's Day.
G'day, guys. Sam Kerridge here from the Carlton Football Club. We're here today at Chemist Warehouse Northland Homemaker Centre to get some goodies for Dad for Father's Day. So we'll head inside now.
going?
Good, thank you. How are you?
Warehouse. What can I do for you today?
I'm just here today looking for some Father's Day gifts for my dad. You know, Dad was pretty important in my junior days. Obviously, being in a country town, getting to and from football was, you know, tough at times. Sometimes he'd be in the car for an hour. And without Dad taking me to and from footy, holding me where I am today. So I'm forever grateful for that. I've learned a heap from my dad, actually. You know, everything from how to kick a footy, how to enjoy life, and, you know, just life skills that you pick up from your parents. And he's been a big influence on my life so far. I see this fragrance around. I reckon I might try some.
Yeah, it's a great idea. It's a great fragrance.
I was in a hotel room draft day. I was a bit nervous and I didn't really want to be around too many people. Dad actually organised the hotel room through one of his contacts, and I was sitting there in a hotel room with Mum, Dad and myself, just sitting there watching the draft, and lucky enough my name got read out. And yeah, Dad was obviously chuffed when it happened. We'd both put in a fair bit of work to get there, and to finally get the opportunity at the highest level was, you know, a great feeling.
Sam, have you seen our new AFL limited edition tins? All 18 teams, and look what's on top, just for you, Carlton.
Fantastic, there you go, Dad. So today I got Dad from Chemist Warehouse some CK cologne, Oral-B toothbrush, and some Carlton fragrance over here from the AFL collection. Happy Father's Day, Dad. Hope you enjoy all these products from Chemist Warehouse.
Beautiful copies, as always, over at the McCafe. We've had Tommy Lonergan on the show, retired last night, going to play the final series, maybe bow out with a premiership. I wanted to ask him one question before we go. You've got a good record on Lance Franklin, the best forward in the game last 20 years. Who's the best player you've played on?
Yeah, well, he's obviously one of them, Brownie. I think Jonathan Brown, though, he's a super player, super brave, and he was also a big competitor too.
Nice work, and we've got the rising star coming up. Any cats spring to mind that maybe?
Yeah, Shift, I want to ask you a question about James Parsons. Has he been close to a nomination? He's had a really consistent year.
Yeah, he's certainly been close a number of occasions. I wouldn't even dismiss him getting the last one because it's on the body of work for the year, not so much how you play in this round. He was injured last night, of course. Will Haywood and Bailey Williams are two others that have had good years.
How do you like the week off? I mean, we're just talking off camera. Guys like you who are older, you like the week off. How's it sit?
Yeah, look, it suits me well. Like, I'll be happy to have a week off, freshen up. But also, I think they could have also had the bye 3 or 4 weeks ago would have been suitable as well.
Nice work. Well, it has been a massive show. We've had James Harms on here, Ebony Marinoff from AFLW. It's been a huge week. Enjoy the finals, enjoy the fight. And for Future Stars, for INC Sports Nutrition, we'll be back next week.